I have to go make one quick call home, okay?
Hmm?
I said I have to go make one quick
call. Okay.
No sound.
Okay.
See what I'm saying?
Yeah. Thank you. Ready to start? Nothing like awkward beginnings. I'd like to call to order the November 1, 2016 meeting of the Buncombe County Board of Commissioners. And if you will join me for the Pledge of Allegiance and invocation, we'll get started.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. If you join me in prayer. Thank you for the opportunity to live in a country based on our right to vote for whoever and whatever we feel like. From our beginnings, the United States has mandated that each level of government leaders be chosen from a private choice made by each resident. Every vote counts the same regardless of wealth, social position, power, or influence in the community. While all of us are weary of the long campaign season, we all benefit from the right to vote without fear of obstacles, punishment, or public identification of our personal decisions in the voting booth. We thank you for a country where election results that choose new leaders are followed up with a peaceful and civil change in government. Many countries find themselves being led by the leader who has the most guns or the most muscle to intimidate others. Bless each one of the candidates who have the political guts to present their views and positions for acceptance or rejections next week. Bless the individuals who work the voting system to ensure fairness, neutrality in votes, and tabulation of results. Bless the people who choose to campaign, argue, debate, canvass, or support or oppose candidates or other ballot decisions. Help us to come together as a state, county, and country after November 8 and work toward policies that help all of us reach the full potential you have planned for each one of us. We're in awe of the American system of government, even as the cumulative effects of a long and sometimes bitter campaign winds down. Thank you for this county, for elections, for government, and the chance to improve others' lives. Amen. In accordance with the code of ethics adopted by the board, all county commissioners have the duty to obey all applicable laws regarding official actions, to uphold the integrity and independence of the office, to avoid impropriety in the exercises of our official duties, to faithfully perform the duties of the office, and to conduct the affairs of the governing board in an open and public manner. Is there any item on the agenda, the outcome of which would have a direct, substantial, and readily identifiable financial impact on any board member? Does any board member have a financial interest on any contract that might come before the board today? Hearing none, I find that all board members have a duty and obligation to vote. Our next order of business will be public comment. We will not be having public comment on the art project unless the commissioner requests that. In pre-session, there was no request. So if anyone has questions or comments about the history wall or the outdoor monument, that would be appropriate to come up during the public comment portion, because there would not be a individual public comment following when we take it up as new business. So the time limit for any comment to the commission is 3 minutes. If your time expires, you may leave any question along with your name, address, phone number, or email with the county manager. Board members are not expected to comment on matters during public comment. This is your time to talk to us. Comments should be limited to subjects that are within the jurisdiction of the commission or pertain to matters upon which we might act. Any individual speaking during public comment shall address the entire board. Any polling of board members is inappropriate. Persons addressing the commission are expected to observe the decorum of the chamber and be respectful of everyone in the room, whether you agree with their opinions or views or not. Anyone who willfully interrupts, disturbs, or disrupts the session will be asked to leave the meeting. And the commission reserves the right to deny any public address on any subject previously presented to the board. I welcome Councilman Young here. Thank you for being here, Keith. And session is open for anyone that wants to give public comment. I will give one more footnote. There will be a public comment on the nonprofit amendments. We will have public comment when we take that up. We will not on the art history wall and monument outside the courthouse. Any public comment? Yes, sir. You two, and then Councilman Young.
Thank you, Commissioners. My name is Robert Lane. I'm a resident of Asheville and hence Buncombe County. The record will also show I'm an older white man. I want to speak to African-American inclusion in the public art process. It is due to my own ignorance that I've just learned that there may be no representation from the African-American community on the committee to choose public art to illustrate Buncombe history. I wish to speak in favor of including African-Americans on the committee, regardless of how the existing absence came to be, assuming that is the case. African-Americans have made major contributions to the development of Buncombe County. After slavery was outlawed, slavery was basically continued by other means, one of which that I personally witnessed as a child, the chain gang. The railroad that came to Western North Carolina to Asheville in October of 1880 was a result of manual labor of thousands of convicts, 90+% of whom were black men, and over 120 of whom died building the railroad up the escarpment from Old Fort to the vicinity of Black Mountain. The first train came to Asheville, the village of Best, where the station was, which is now Biltmore Village, in October of 1880. At that time, it was Best because a young man by the name of George Vanderbilt had not yet brought his mama on the train to Asheville to see this and to take the air. Had the train not been here when he took his mama to take the airs, where might he have taken her instead of here, and how might our history have been very different? Also, I'm sure you're probably more aware than I am, but I have learned recently about the history of Stevens Lee High School, a really high-quality school that closed upon integration, and its history was basically lost. The trophies and awards that were in the trophy cases there were not moved. Only the students were moved from that high school to the formerly white high school. These parts of history are not generally out there. I see monuments to the guy who was the driving force behind getting that railroad built so quickly and killing so many people. And he's done great things for our state, and I don't disapprove of the monument to Zeb Vance. But where is the monument to the people who actually did the work to make it happen? I hope that can be changed. And commissioners, the history of the black community here is one of loss, and it is one of contributions. And we don't see that very publicly. It's often just ignored. Neither you nor I can change what has occurred in the past, but you do have it in your power to right a wrong here. I urge you to defer a decision on a public art project until the committee has had time to add representation from the African-American community and get that community's input. Thank you. All
right, thank you, Robert. We appreciate your comments. Yes, any other let's see, ma'am, you'll be next, and then Councilman Young. And who wants to speak after? Mr. Murdoch will be after Councilman Young.
Commissioners, my name is Eleanor Lane, and I live in Asheville in Buncombe County, and I wish to comment on the art project history wall. Recently, two African-American women friends said to me and others, Asheville does not want us here. We have so much to contribute to the community if only we were given the opportunity. I read the article in the Asheville Citizen Times and felt compelled to come here and speak. I don't know the circumstances under which the county staff chose to exclude African American voices from the process of selecting artists and projects for Buncombe County's public art, but I strongly urge you to stop the process now and start anew, this time with true representation from our entire county. I want to be able to go back to my friends and report that the Buncombe County Commissioners took action that says African American residents' opinions matter and are valued, and voices will not be excluded. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Arlene. Councilman?
Good afternoon, Chairman Gant, to the rest of your fellow commissioners. I'm looking around, and my presence here is kind of odd because it doesn't look like the chambers that I'm necessarily used to. So to put that into some context, I'll just say, Toto, I don't think I'm in Kansas anymore. But at any rate, you know, I'll try to keep my remarks short and to the point. And it's not my intention to delve into the specifics of any matter that I'm here to address specifically, nor is it my intention to interject myself into the deliberations of your body. However, being the only African-American elected official to a governing body here in the county, I felt it only my due diligence to make my presence felt here today. As you all know, the city of Asheville has made a concerted effort to advance equity and diversity, and we're working on communications in those levels. In recent developments, I think folks have read some Citizen Times articles. There was one by Miss Emily Patrick. I think it was dated October the 27th, that you may be aware of, and entitled Request to Include African Americans in the Art Process Not Heeded. And the very first sentence of that article, this isn't me, this is in the article itself, so I'll quote it verbatim. The future of $75,000 for public art intended to represent Buncombe County's history and culture has so far been determined entirely by white people, running counter to a goal to bring diversity to the process. So here's my take on that. I could have definitely picked up the phone and called any one of you and made made how I felt, you know, behind the scenes and personal or whatever, but I chose not to do that. I chose to come and actually state this in person. Selfishly, I think I just wanted to get from under the shadow of City Hall and come say hi in person. So, hi. With that being said, I would just hope that this body would take heed and include some other voices into the conversation. I think the project is well intended, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be an awesome project. Definitely something that will say people to match our mountains, and I definitely hope that it will be all people. So with that being said, I'll leave my comments at that and just want to say thank you for your consideration on making some adjustments to the process. Thank you definitely for your service. I know how hard that is, and I appreciate the ability to come up here and address you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Yes, sir, Mr. Murdoch. And who wants to speak after Mr. Murdoch? Yes, ma'am, you'll be next. You can come on and get in the front row. And Mr. Rice, you can come on up if you like. Just sit on the front row and we'll get you as you sit.
Chairman Gant, commissioners, thank you so much. This is the first time I've ever actually made a public comment anywhere in something like this. But it's just a little different. First of all, I just wanted to come on behalf of Eblen Charities, behalf of all the families that we serve, the tens of thousands of families, and just to say thank you for letting us work with you and the fact that you haven't forgotten the families who are less fortunate, the families who line up at our door at 5 o'clock in the morning. And just wanted to say how much that is appreciated, especially in the vitriolic times we live in, especially during elections, that folks don't realize that. And just we contract with you all for so many things, heating and housing and so much, and that has continued to grow. So I just want to say thank you for allowing us to be part of the outreach that you have. And also to give you a quick update about our teacher housing project, which is going very, very well, thanks to you all, of course, donating the property and MSD working with us. And we're starting sheetrocking the first building this week. And framing is going up on the second building, so we should be open for business by April, I think. So it's all going extremely well. A little slower start than we thought, but it came out to be a much stronger project than we initially had. So again, I just want to thank you all so much, especially on behalf of the people that don't always get to come up here, the families that are struggling every day, having to make a choice between food and medicine and heat. And thanks to you and allowing us to be part of that. So many families breathe easier. So I just wanted to come on behalf of that and say thank you all very, very much.
Thank you for decades of taking care of people, Bill. Eblen is amazing. Sasha, come on up.
Hi. Thank you all for your service and for your work. I thank you especially for your work in helping to form the African American Heritage Commission. My name is Sasha Mitchell. I'm the chair of the African American Heritage Commission, and I'm not speaking for our commission because we haven't been able to meet officially, but I'm speaking as the chair and as someone who's heard a lot from the community since the story was out in the paper. I'm grateful also for the help of our county staff liaison, Carla Freneri, who has helped us with funding for creating our brochures that celebrate Asheville and Buncombe County's African American heritage. I am grateful that going forward, however this process proceeds, I've heard that the African American community will be welcome to participate in contributing thoughts on and our input as to what is represented in the public art. But I do agree and hope that there will be a delay in the process so that we can more fully participate. We welcome the opportunity. We're eager to be part of the recorded history in more ways than we have been. And I just thank you for considering it.
Thank you, and thank you for your leadership on the commission.
Thank you.
Mr. Rice.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Member Ford. Glad you got to see me. Nonprofits, that's been an issue ever since I've been here, 20-some years. It's been a hot topic. It's been political. It's been politicized to death, and I think it's even getting worse. One of the big things about nonprofits that has not been secured yet is open transparency on the books. They get to Wanda, but they don't get any further. Nobody gets the opportunity to see anything except the internal people. That's not right. Think about it. How many nonprofits are they in Buncombe County? The last count I had looked like 800. What is that doing to our property taxes? Think about that. Okay, the contracts that you're talking about versus giving them money on nonprofits. Well, contracts and nonprofit money has always been the same. Now, the other thing is startup money. It didn't start until Pisgah Legal asked for $500,000. That's when this money started. Let me tell you something about Pisgah Legal. They've been good to certain points. But if you can't serve your community except on the phone and do your kids on the phone or your public people on the phone, and you can't show up in the courtroom and do a trial, then you shouldn't be representing the client. That's what I think about Pisgah Legal. And I like Pisgah Legal. Don't get me wrong. But they should shore some things up. But transparency. You said Buncombe County residents when we're talking about this money. I don't see how you separate Buncombe County residents when you're talking about nonprofits. I don't see how you do it. Because a lot of the issues are right here in the city of Asheville, and they need that support as well. I don't see how you separate a nonprofit giving them money that way. Now, we have had more poor people in Buncombe County, and I don't think, Commissioner, Chairman Gant, that you feel good about this. You've been here a long time. They ain't nothing you or none of the others have done, including all of you, that have helped the poor like they should. We are getting the worst kind of poor we could be. And that's a good point of what we're looking at when we look at no jobs. We ain't got nothing to sustain us. Now, I'm going to leave you with a question. Is the nonprofits truly effective as they should be? We need some goals that's set for outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rice. Any other members of the public wish to be heard tonight? Seeing none, I'll declare the general public comment session closed. Is there a motion to follow the agenda with the to move this resolution of intent to solicit bids for the sale of Buncombe County property? I think I'll put that at the end of new business.
So moved.
Okay. Is there a second? Okay. Motion by Commissioner Frost, a second by Commissioner Moffitt to approve the amended agenda. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Then we will proceed as the chair has discussed. Next item we have is good news. We have proclamation of Adult Awareness Month. And I think Angie Gardner's here with Health and Human Services. Come on up, Angie, and I think Commissioner Belcher's going to present this with you.
Adoption awareness.
Hi there.
I think I'll read the proclamation and let you speak after that. I did this a year ago, and a personal story. I have an adopted grandson that just turned a year, and such a blessing in our life. And so this is near and dear to my heart, and I'm privileged to read this tonight on behalf of all the commissioners. County of Buncombe proclamation of November as Adoption Awareness Month. Whereas Adoption Awareness Month is celebrated to call attention to the fact that every child deserves to grow up in a loving, nurturing, permanent home, and that this experience lays the foundation for a happy, productive adulthood. And whereas in North Carolina last year there were approximately 15,892 children living away from their birth parents, 1,344 of these children were adopted. And whereas in Buncombe County, there are 328 children in foster care, and adoption is the permanency plan for approximately 159 children who are waiting for a forever family. And whereas during the month of November, Buncombe County Human Services, private adoption agencies, the faith community, and local advocacy groups will participate in a statewide public awareness campaign around adoption. This collaborative effort will focus greater attention on children who need permanent adoptive families and honor families who have adopted children. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed by the Board of Commissioners for the County of Buncombe as follows. Number one, that the month of November 2016 be proclaimed Adoption Awareness Month in Buncombe County. Number two, that all citizens, community agencies, religious organizations, businesses, and others be encouraged to celebrate adoption and honor adoptive families by increasing their awareness of the issues of adoption and helping to focus attention on the need for adoptive parents and the children who are waiting for permanent homes. Number three, that this proclamation be effective upon its adoption. Adopted this the first day of November 2016 by the Board of Commissioners, County of Buncombe, signed by David Gant, Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I move adoption of this proclamation.
Thank you. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of adopting the proclamation as stated by Commissioner Belcher, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Thank you, Commissioner. Angie?
Thank you. I just want to say a few words. Yes. That we do have almost 330 children in custody. And when we do have children in custody, our number one plan and goal, if appropriate, is reunification with their birth families to help give these families and these children the support and the services that they need. And that is our best hope, that we can make the family healthy and reunify these children with their families. If that is not the case and doesn't work out to be that way, our next plan would be adoption. And so right now, as of today, since January 1st, we have 17 children that have been in our care that have been adopted and now are in forever and permanent homes. And so that's, again, something that we really strive for, the reunification, and we appreciate the services that the county provides to our families to help, you know, again, get them healthy and learn how to parent their children in a better manner. But if not, we also have these wonderful foster families who take these children in, work with their families, and ultimately are able to provide permanency for these children if reunification is not in their best interest. So we appreciate everything you do. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gardner. Next on the agenda, we have four public hearings, and Debbie Trumphy will explain each one. Any member of the public is welcome to speak after any of these. We'll have four separate public hearings. The first one will be text amendment to Chapter 58, Article 3, the Farmland Preservation Program. Ms. Trumphy?
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the proposed text amendments to Article 3 of Chapter 58 of the Buncombe County Code of Ordinances are to provide clarification on farmland preservation program procedures and to be consistent with North Carolina general statutes. During the last USDA Agricultural Conservation Easement Program grant cycle, Buncombe County was determined to be ineligible for funding due to the Farmland Preservation Ordinance's deficiencies in procedures and policies regarding conservation easements. By clarifying and adding certain elements to the ordinance, the county will again be eligible for USDA ASEP funding for conservation easements. While we were reviewing the ordinance, we found some discrepancies between state statute and the ordinance, and changes are proposed to address those inconsistencies as well. Mm-hmm. The proposed amendments articulate the purpose of the farmland program, refine some definitions and add some new definitions, clarify requirements for membership on the Agricultural Advisory Board, clarify procedures for the board and board duties, change the requirements for conservation agreements, membership in voluntary agricultural districts, and enhanced voluntary agricultural districts, and conservation easements to be consistent with state statutes. The amendments add additional requirements for public notification of voluntary agricultural districts and enhanced voluntary agricultural districts, and also clarify notification requirements to state agencies. In the conservation easement program section, policies and procedures have been clarified or added so that Buncombe County would again be eligible for USDA ASEP funding. The amendments include authorization for the Soil and Water Conservation District to apply for grant funding and to enter into cooperative agreements with other agencies to facilitate easement purchases. They provide clarification of responsibilities and procedures for ranking easement applications and the acquisition, lease, and donation of easements. And we've added new sections that outline requirements and procedures for baseline documentation and monitoring of conservation easements, for appraisals for those easements, and for remedy of violation of those easements. Additionally, we have removed the ranking forms from the ordinance itself. Those are administrative forms which require revision from time to time and should not have been codified. The Agriculture Advisory Board reviewed the proposed changes over several meetings and unanimously recommends approval of the amendments at their October 18th meeting by a vote of 6-0. And I'll be happy to answer any questions you have for me.
Any questions for Ms. Trumphy before we commence the public hearing?
I just have a quick question. So, assuming that we make these changes, which
thank you, Jerry. Sorry about that. Upon adoption of these amendments, will we at that moment be able to go forward with the USDA request, or do we lose a year?
They have reviewed the changes and think that they will be satisfactory, and the grant cycle has just opened up, so we would be able to make this current grant cycle.
Oh, fantastic.
Good. Any other questions before the public hearing? Thank you, Ms. Trumpy. Then I'll declare the public hearing in the text amendment to the Farmland Preservation Program Ordinance open at 4:56. Any members of the public wish to be heard on this? Yes, sir.
My name is David Lee. I'm the chairman of the Farmland Preservation Board. I just wanted to say that a lot of work went into the revision of the ordinance. My first time in doing that, and I didn't realize just how extensive a process it was, but we did do a lot of work. We are unanimous in support of that and would appreciate positive vote on it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Lee. Thank you for leading that board, very important board. Any other members of the public wish to be heard on this amendment? Seeing none, I will declare the public hearing closed at 4:58. Discussion among the board, or any questions about what we have before us? Basically, it sounds like it lets us get back in the possibility of getting federal funding and cleans up a lot of other things that we had a long time. This is a 49 page. How many pages? This is a lot.
A lot.
49 pages of changes. So thank you for Mr. Lee. Thank you for painstakingly going through. That's a lot. Any questions?
Mr. Chairman, I'll move approval.
There's been a motion for approval of the amendments by Commissioner Belcher. Is there a second?
Second.
There's a second by Commissioner Jones. Any further discussion? Any other discussion of the farmland preservation amendments? Okay. All those in favor? There's been a motion by Commissioner Belcher, second by Commissioner Jones. I'll call the question. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Then those amendments are adopted by a 7-0 vote. Ms. Trumpy, number two, we've got text amendment to Chapter 78, the zoning changes.
Okay. The following three public hearings on proposed text amendments to the zoning ordinance, the land development and subdivision ordinance, and Chapter 58, Article 2, the Planning Board, are all in response to changes to state statutes and also a recent court decision regarding quasi-judicial proceedings. For the proposed amendments to Chapter 78, Section 78-623 of the Zoning Ordinance, the amendment is to bring consistency with state statutes regarding procedures for the filing of decisions. And that's decisions of the Board of Adjustment. It requires that the person who delivers the decision of the Board of Adjustment to applicants, owners, any other person who requests a copy of that decision, that person certifies that proper notice has been made. So it's just one paragraph added to the zoning ordinance. The Planning Board held a public hearing on this proposed amendment on October the 3rd of this year, and there was no public comment. The board found that the proposed amendment is consistent with the land use plan, is reasonable and in the public interest, and unanimously recommended approval. I'd be happy to answer any questions you have now.
In practical terms, is that person the chair of the board, or is that the staff?
It is staff that delivers those decisions.
Gotcha.
And then that staff person, just to be clear and eliminate chances of mistakes happening, just have been added so that person
makes
certifies
sense.
That notice has been made.
Thank you.
Any other questions before we have our public hearing on this?
So of course, we have several of these. What was driving the changes of these? It was just state
requirements. State statute, and just to make it clear who delivers, who has delivered the notifications, that they certify that that was done so.
Any other questions for Ms. Trumpy before we begin the public hearing?
Mr. Chair, I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Ms. Trumpy, thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Trumpy, regarding the filing of the decisions, how much time does the Board of Adjustment have before they are required or compelled to file their written decision with the zoning administrator?
There's not a time limit on that. The time starts for appeals once that notice has been delivered. Okay. So if someone wanted to appeal the board's decision, they have to receive that notification, and then the clock starts.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Hearing none, I'll declare the public hearing in the zoning amendments, Chapter 78, open at 5:02. Does any member of the public wish to be heard on these amendments? Hearing no request, I will declare the public hearing closed at 5:03. What's the pleasure of the board on this text amendment?
Move to adopt.
Been a motion by Commissioner Moffitt. There's a second by Commissioner Fryer to adopt the text amendment as articulated by Ms. Trumpy. Any questions or any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. 7-0, the amendments are passed. Next, we have text amendments to Chapter 70, the subdivision ordinance. Ms. Trumpy?
The proposed amendments to Chapter 70, Sections 70-10 and 70-41 of the Land Development and Subdivision Ordinance are to bring the subdivision variance procedures into alignment with state statutes and zoning requirements. The variance section of the ordinance has been modified to clarify standards for establishing the hardship for the variance, for making findings of fact, and for sending notice of those findings. There's also a proposed amendment to clarify that vested rights for phased development are pursuant to North Carolina General Statutes, which can be up to 7 years for certain phased developments. The Planning Board held a public hearing on the proposed amendments to the Land Development and Subdivision Ordinance on October 3rd, 2016, and there was no public comment. The Board unanimously recommended approval of the amendments in a vote of 6-0.
All right.
You have questions for me?
Thank you. Then I, hearing no questions prior to the public hearing, we'll go ahead and declare the public hearing open in the text amendments to Chapter 70 subdivision ordinance. Does any member at 5:05, does any member of the public wish to be heard on this? Mm-hmm. Seeing none, I will declare the public hearing closed at 5:06. Any members of the board have any questions or comments or motions on this proposal?
I just have a little thing. It's not related to the content of the, it's, I was just reading the resolution and it said that it was a 6-0 vote by the board. And is it just standard? Because, but when it's the listed here, the planning board members, there's more than six there. So
there are nine members. There were six at that meeting.
So I guess it's just right. So that's so it's good enough to get it by, which is fantastic. But I was just wondering, it says, I mean, I just wonder why you just didn't list the people that were there as opposed to all the members of the board.
Generally, we mark absent besides the ones that are not there. It's prepared beforehand, and it should have been marked absent for those that were not voting.
Clarify the record for that. So when we do have it, it'll be consistent with what we usually do. So I like to see who's
showing up in meetings and who's not. So that's what I was looking for, among other things. But
we will make sure that's accurate next time.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Mr. Belcher.
One question. So do you have a, just for the record, do you have a simple example of a hardship?
Hardships are generally something that is peculiar to a piece of property rather than a personal hardship.
Okay.
So a hardship might be that there's a certain area where a septic system has to go, so the house is required to be in another position which might not meet setback requirements.
Okay.
And that would be a hardship peculiar to the property. A hardship that is personal is maybe it would be less expensive to build it this way, or I just want to build it this way and am asking for a variance, and that's not a legitimate reason.
Okay, so number one, that's an excellent answer. Second, the way I'm reading this is the first example you gave, this makes it not necessarily easier, but not harder to apply for that variance, right?
It doesn't make it easier or harder. It just is consistent with the statutes as okay. they were changed. There was changes in the wording.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? On our prior vote, we voted for the resolution. Should we have done a resolution of consistency also?
I'm sorry. Yes, you should have. Thank you for bringing that up.
Commissioner Moffitt for catching that. Is there? Let me go back to that one. Go ahead and clean that up first.
78. You want to make the 78?
Yeah. Is there a motion for to pass the resolution of consistency on the Chapter 78 ordinance, zoning ordinance?
So moved.
Motion by Commissioner Moffitt. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Frost. Any discussion of that before we get to the one before us? All those in favor of the resolution of consistency of Chapter 78 zoning ordinance, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Then that resolution of consistency is adopted by a 7-0 vote. Now, we do have the Chapter 70 subdivisions, which I do not see a resolution of consistency. Is that not required?
That's not required just for the zoning ordinance.
Okay.
Move approval.
There's been a motion by Commissioner Belcher. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. There's been a motion by Commissioner Belcher, a second by Commissioner Jones to approve the ordinance approving the text amendments to Chapter 70 subdivision ordinance. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The text amendments to Chapter 70 passed by a 7-0 vote. Our final public hearing today, scheduled public hearing, we are going to have one on the nonprofit amendments, is text amendment to Chapter 58, Planning and Development. Ms. Trumpy.
So this is our last public hearing on a proposed amendments, and this is Chapter 78, Article 2, the Planning Board. The amendments are to bring consistency with general statutes and a recent court decision regarding quasi-judicial proceedings. The proposed amendments affect how the Planning Board votes on variances and appeals and how public hearings are conducted and advertised. The proposed amendments also clarify administrative procedures for the Planning Board. The amendments specify the number of members required for a quorum and require that a record be maintained of members present. Clarify procedures for election of officers, procedures for special meetings, cancellation of meetings, and the record of proceedings. The amendments add a section on rules of conduct, which specify cause for removal, require meeting attendance, prohibit acceptance of gift and favors, provide standards for administering oaths, and state requiring voting requirements. A section has been added on regular business, and that specifies order of business and outlines standards for action and motions by the board. A section has been added on quasi-judicial hearings, which outline procedures for hearings on appeals and variances, requirements for voting on quasi-judicial matters, standards for impartiality and conduct of the hearings. A section on quasi-judicial decisions and judicial review has also been added, which states that the conduct of hearings and decisions be in accordance with North Carolina general statutes and adds procedures for the filing of decisions. The Planning Board held a public hearing on the proposed amendments to Chapter 58, Article 2 on October the 3rd of this year, and there was no public comment. The Board unanimously recommended approval of the amendments by a vote of 6-0. Do you have any questions on this one?
Question, Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I was just reading through it, trying to find what I'm looking for, but perhaps you can help me. If every member is required to vote unless they have a conflict, correct?
Yes.
What if someone abstains and they just refuse to vote? Is that vote counted as an affirmative or as a negative?
If the board votes to recuse them, then it doesn't count. If they just refuse to vote, then it is an affirmative vote.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions before we have our public hearing? Thank you. I will declare the public hearing in the text amendment to Chapter 58, Planning and Development, open at 5:12. Does any member of the public wish to be heard on this amendment? Seeing none, I will declare the public hearing closed at 5:13. Is there any further discussion or motion by the board?
Move approval. Second.
Been a motion by Commissioner Jones, a second by Commissioner Frost to approve the amendments as presented. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The text amendment passes 7-0. Okay. Yeah. All right, we do not have a county manager's report tonight. We take up new business. I have had a request to have public comment on the history wall, and I will grant that at the end of the discussion. So is there any, or I can summarize, I guess.
We thought you might summarize.
Okay, all right. At our last meeting, we had a hearing and presentation of response to our request for proposals for the first art that we have financed in Buncombe County history. The proposals were presented during the hearing for the first time. The board at that point made a motion and decided to table the matter to get further input and to review and discuss amongst ourselves in less than four at a table the merits of the proposals. The matter is now before us again. We have two distinct projects that are being considered. There is a history wall project that was funded at $25,000 to be constructed inside the courthouse on some of the courthouse walls. At the original approval of this back in, I think it was May of 15 or March of 15. It was
May, I believe.
I think it was May of 15.
Okay.
There was comments from Commissioner Jones specifically to include the African American community in the planning and discussion. There were extensive meetings with the arts and the community. We heard from Gigi Francis, who is here today, discussing that talked about the input and what was done. There was concern at the last meeting, again, by both, I think, Commissioner Frost and maybe Commissioner Jones. Another occasion talked about the inclusion of African-American community in the planning of the history wall. So we have it before us. We have four proposals, including a and so why don't I get you to come back up and talk about the proposal, just summarize them again, Ms. Francis. And we in the board's possibilities are to approve the, we're going to take them one by one, the history wall, and we're going to have public hearing on the history wall. And then we're going to vote what to do. And then we're going to hear about the. We're going to have a public hearing and discussion about the monument outside the courthouse. And so, if we could start with the history wall, let's talk about that. and what the proposals were, and any what if any feedback you've gotten in the last 2 weeks.
Okay, Judy, could you pull that up, please? Since the majority of this presentation is just describing what the concepts of the artists were, I could go ahead and start with that while we have the technology catch up. The space that we were talking about for the history wall is to the right of the elevators as you are going into the new courthouse. There is a wall that has a center section that is 10 feet by 16 feet. And there's a little bit of surrounding space. There's also been identified a second possible space for art to the left of the elevators as you are going in. The first proposal was from Virginia Derryberry, who lives in Asheville. She is a renowned artist, and her concept for the history wall is to create two 10-foot by 7-foot panels to be mounted on the wall with 2 feet in between them. One panel will have a background of the Pisgah Mountain Range, and the other will have a backdrop of the French Broad River Valley. And the panels will be the backdrop for smaller framed canvases showing aspects of Buncombe County history, portraits of people, significant buildings, and major attractions such as the Biltmore Estate and the Grove Park Inn. The background panels will have a softer color palette. And the small canvases will have more realistic detail and more of a pop of color. Her budget for the project was $5,000, and she expects the project can be completed in approximately 2 months. The second proposal was from Jason Rafferty. He is also a resident of Asheville, and he has a large body of work out already. He included a sketch of his concept of the proposal, and the concept sketch represented 25 individuals from Asheville's past, including George Vanderbilt, Thomas Wolfe, construction workers, museums, and other people who live and reside in the area. Significant buildings and landmarks are included in the background, and the color palette that he chose would be to have the older, more sepia tones for the older part of the images, and then moving to the modern day, current, contemporary people with brighter colors and more vibrant art. His budget for the project was $24,500, and he said that it would require an extended timeline for completion. He expected the work would begin in the summer of 2017 and wrap up sometime in the summer of 2018. This is because he would be working with an additional group of artists. He said that it would be four additional artists in addition to himself preparing this tapestry and panel for the wall. The third proposal is from David Wilson. David Wilson is from Durham, North Carolina. He has also done notable scaled public art projects. And his art includes taking photographs and images and layering them to create kind of a quilt effect. He has done bus stop surrounds. He has done several other major works in Charlotte. His concept for the history wall is to use sandborne maps, historic images, and color panels to create a stained glass look. He will use ink printed on vinyl to capture light and reflections and provide depth to the work on the wall. The budget for this project is $5,000, and the timeline for completion is 30 to 45 days once the final design has been approved. The fourth option was for library staff to select images from the North Carolina Room archives. What we showed was just a sample of different pictures that are in the collection, and since then we've taken another look at it, and we've realized that trying to get all of Buncombe County history in one panel is kind of impossible. So we started looking at people,
on one panel and places on another panel. The staff actually sat down and brainstormed things for symbols and places and people to be included. They came up with a list, and in the North Carolina room, there are several large tables that are approximately 5 feet by 8 feet, which just happens to be about half the size of the panel we're talking about. They went ahead and actually found some images and laid them out on the table to see how many we would actually be talking about. The idea here was that this would be about half size. So most of the images that they came up with are 8.5 by 11, which would make them approximately 17 by 22 on the wall, and it would be a size that could be seen fairly easily within the courthouse. In terms of people, they were thinking about Wilma Dykeman and T.S. Morrison and Killian Exum Clement and Nicholas Woodfin. And basically at that point they were saying, you know, we have so many things here that we do need input from the public. So at that point we would love to be able to include other members of the community to help us make sure that this is a truly representative wall. Basically what they came up with was 65 images. So if we were to go ahead and have 65 significant images, there are so many people in Buncombe County history, we would need help in figuring out who those significant people would be. The same problem in terms of places, because Buncombe County is beautiful, but we have lots of beautiful fields. Most people know about the landmarks in Asheville, so we started taking a look at different overlooks from the Blue Ridge Parkway. Farms, different locations, different locales, Smith McDowell House, of course, educational institutions, Stevens Lee College, UNCA, AB Tech, some of the older Asheville school buildings. And again, there is so much that we would need help in going ahead and finding what is best to represent the public.
And budget on number four?
Budget on number four could be up to $25,000, depending on how detailed we want to be. The quick and dirty numbers are approximately $2,500 per panel, but that doesn't involve some of the different things that we could do. One of the things that David Wilson showed is that if you get a really good graphic artist working with you, you can layer things in such a way that if you see it from head on, you see one thing. If you see it from a slightly different angle, you see another image. So we would want to go ahead and contract with a graphic artist to help come up with the final product.
All right. Any questions for Ms. Francis, before we're going to have a public hearing on this, or any discussion before we have a public hearing?
Ms. Francis,
Chairman.
Commissioner? In the last meeting, my memory, if it's not failing me, on the fourth one, we were talking between $1,500 and $2,000.
Right. Then we realized how many images we're talking about, and realizing that there are different treatments available for these, so that we could go ahead and do a very polished professional job. We could also do a more scaled back.
Well, one thing that personally, this is mm-hmm. just personal, that I was looking at is we have so much, and the African American community needs to be involved in
yes.
this totally. I agree 100%. But as the years go on, the history is going to change. And we can change the wall periodically if we utilize what we have without going into a position of, you know, specialty. These are special photos to start with. And the wall over there, if you go in and you end up going in 5 years later, something different was there. In my particular eyes, it would be different. It's something that you're not looking at consistently. And the originals that you have is something that I would really like to see.
Okay.
Thank you.
I know. Sir, Commissioner, any other comments before or questions before we have a public hearing?
I'll have some comments after the public speaks. And I know some people have already.
Yeah.
I just not doing a good job today. Good. I don't have any questions now, but I definitely will have some comments after the deliberation. And I just wanted folks, if they want to speak again, that have already addressed the subject, they're obviously welcome. But also know that your comments were noted and heard in the prior public comment. This just gives, if some people came in later, it gives ample opportunity for more folks.
Yes, I did announce in the pre-session and at the beginning of the meeting we would not be taking public comment. We are going to take public comment on the art project, and the public comment at this point is going to be about the history wall. You are welcome to speak again. We did change the rules because the commissioners wanted to get public comment. We thought it was important. Do any members of the public wish to be heard on the history wall proposal? Mr. Rice? Oh, God. Anybody after Mr. Rice? Yes, ma'am. You'll be next after Mr. Rice.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I think Mr. Fry hit on a good point, and I can take it from there. What I look at is as much history as we have here, there's no way to tell it all. So what I would call this is a rotating history wall. Have it fixed to where ever so often you can set up new designs. And that's what Mr. Fry is alluding to. And I think this way you can get a lot more history in. And the other piece is this, even better. I think the financial piece could be supported by community in different ways if there's a committee put together to investigate whose interest is where and have it fixed to where it's a fair process, and they might even donate the money or donate a piece of item or something, and that way you'd have a perpetual revolving door that would always have something fresh about the history. And then if it gets to the point, again, just rotate it back to the beginning, and you've got it built up over time. So it don't make sense for the county to keep putting money into this thing. You know, I never did like to look at one thing all the time, even in the mirror. You know what I'm saying? So history is beautiful, and we need to preserve it. But I think it's a lot more. I love what the gentleman said about the railroad workers. You know, we get enough of you politicians on the wall. We need people that actually grunted and done the work. We need people that, you know, stands out and means something in the community. You know, politicians just weren't, I'm just telling you. I'm glad this election is over about it, you know.
Amen.
But now the stationary pieces that we're talking about on the wall, those things, there's some things that are stationary that you really want to stay there for long periods of time. But I think Mr. Fry's got a great, great way of thinking here, and I'm going to call it the rotating history wall.
Thank you, Mr. Rice. Yes, ma'am. Anyone want to speak after this lady? Yes. Oh, yeah. Just stretching back there. Okay. You faked me out there. Go ahead, ma'am.
My name is Joy McConnell, and I'm a resident of Buncombe County, far east, south of Black Mountain, up on a little mountain ridge. I'm very concerned about the inclusion of African American members, citizens of our county, in this process. And I have one question, which was the only proposal I heard that even mentioned African American history was the final one. That is my major concern. I think I know that there are several people in the African American community who have compiled photographs of the history, that so much of which has been lost, of the block, of the YMI, of the whole African American community that was basically wiped out during urban renewal. And I would just love to see that not disappear. I think we need to provide for the children a sense that they belong here, that African American children belong here as much as the white children do, and that they have a history. and that they deserve to be represented so that they can have a vision for their own future here in Buncombe County. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McConnell. Any other members of the public wish to be heard on the history wall public hearing? All righty. We have any other questions for Ms. Francis?
I'd like to make a motion. We postpone any activity on the wall until we've had information from our whole community. There's no reason to wonder why this happened, but it happens all the time to minorities. It happens all the time. And we can fix it right now by stopping any further talk about this wall and become inclusive, not set a timeline on it, but really do it the way we should do it. So that was my
second. And a motion by Commissioner Frost, second. Is there any discussion of the motion?
Yeah, I do think there's some discussion that should be had. I've just got a few comments and thoughts. And, you know, when we first talked about a history wall, to me, that would include people and places and everybody. And it would be a living document. I mean, I would see a history wall changing, you know, over time. Not the past, but as the future becomes the present. You know, there's going to be some things that we want to, people and places we want to recognize. The other thing I want to make sure of is that in the history wall that the faith community is represented. When I looked at some of the drawings, I did not see that. I want to make sure that is represented from all, whether it be, Billy Graham or whether it be the rich history and the black community as far as the faith community. So a history wall is a very difficult assignment. I mean, you've got to get everything and everybody in there, and it's going to take some time. And the art is different. I mean, if we want to put a piece of art somewhere, then we just decide, you know, who's applying for it, do we like it, and we can hang it in one place or move it to another place. But a history wall, whether it's in a business, that's where we kind of started out when we got on a history wall discussion. We were talking about what you might even see in a corporation, timelines, things like that, companies that have been around for a long time. And it needs to be, I think it also needs to be able to teach the children. When you look at some of it, you need to know whether this is the 1860s or this is the 1920s or, you know, this was during this particular era or time if we want to teach the kids. Because a lot of our school children do visit there. They come to the chambers here, they go to the courthouse, they go different places. So, and it's going to take some time, I think, to do this. I'm okay with waiting. It's going to take some time to make sure we get it right, I think. But it's two different discussions. We're talking about a history wall, and then we're talking about some art. You know, and if the commission is going to do a history wall, then we need to be all in, do a history wall, study other cities, you know, look at some other examples. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. And it can be done in a practical and a beautiful way, I think. But I'm okay with waiting.
All right. Any other commissioners' comments?
I do, Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
I guess a comment and a question. I'm not sure which order they'll go in. I agree with everything that's been said, but I want to make sure that I'm understanding where we are, or that also that the public understands where we're headed. We as a commission, this is a question for you, Mr. Chairman. We as a commission are to decide from the proposals submitted to us. Is that correct?
We have we have the option of approving one of the designs before us or rejecting the bids, and we can instruct to reject and go out for rebid. Is that correct?
And I think there's a third option if you want to instruct us to work with the appropriate people in the community to to develop a history wall using our resources at the library. That's an option we could also take
options.
A look at.
All right. We have allocated $25,000 for the history wall at earlier date, so that's still out there.
Okay. So we can determine African-American participation. Are we – if we were to to not go with any of the proposals in front of us and go back out to rebid, are we to expect a bid put forth by someone from the African American community?
My motion was really clear. It was to postpone any action on this. It was really clear.
I certainly understand that, Commissioner Frost. What I'm trying to understand is,
we're back to the drawing
board. What
does
the involvement? What are we expecting? Are we expecting?
We're hoping that this time we can get input from our whole community.
Well, I understand that, but what? How do we quantify that so we can make a decision either next meeting or pass on to the next commission? That's my question. I mean, some of this commission will participate in the process, some won't. But when the facts are presented to us and we have to cast a vote, how are we to quantify those results from this process?
Postpone is postpone, and I specifically didn't put a timeline on it because clearly we have an upward hill to travel to make this inclusive, and so that's why I chose not to put a timeline on it. Postpone means simply that. Postpone, put it off.
Can I ask the question?
Let me recognize the county manager first.
We do have to deal with the bids that we have on hand. Either we need to accept them or to reject them. And then we can get instructions, frankly, on how you would like us to proceed. But there's usually a time limit on how long a bid is good for. So we do need to, if we don't want any of the art pieces that were brought forward, we need to decide accept or reject.
So we really don't have the option to postpone directly. We got to accept or not accept.
I can change my motion to not accept any of the bids and postpone further action on this.
Okay. I think, was that procedurally?
Yes.
Okay. Postpone and no action. Okay. Mr. Moffitt.
Just clarification. When you're, Commissioner Frost, when you're saying postponing action, that's official action from our part, but not postponing action from the community in regards to its engagement to move this process down the road, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. There's a motion to postpone and take no action on the proposals before us. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
I do have a couple of other kind of related questions or
Mr.
comments,
Vice
so
Chair.
I guess. So if the motion is approved, I guess just I think it would be good for there to be a bit more discussion about, as the conversation goes out into the community, are we still open to kind of all of these different possibilities, or are we just focused on this history wall concept? That may be something else that we want to take up as a secondary question after we vote on this one. I'll just go ahead and share a few thoughts about that.
Go ahead. Yes, sir.
I really like the idea of the history wall. I would also say I think the proposals that were brought to us, I mean, clearly we need to take more time. It's good that we, at our last meeting, agreed to take more time and get public input. And since we've done that, we've clearly realized we need a lot more public input, and we're going to do that, I'm sure. With that said, I do think the proposals that were brought to the county were really very good, and I thought they were interesting. I'm really glad we had great folks from the community putting proposals forward. So I think the history wall concept could be terrific as well. So for myself, I guess I remain very open to kind of different, what may be the best outcome, either a history wall or commissioning an artist to do a project for the space. It sounds like one of the attributes of the history wall is it was less expensive. Although again, I must say I was very impressed by what these artists proposed to do with really very modest budgets. I thought they were all surprisingly affordable for what they were talking about delivering as a product. It sounds like the art wall might be a little bit more expensive than was initially discussed. So, for myself, I'm very open to the art wall. I'm also open to inviting other proposals as this process does go forward in the community.
Well, and I think, too, we have tremendous resources in the community. We appointed the African American Heritage Commission. So that is a great resource. Also, the tremendous youth involvement in our community, contacting the schools, making it far more inclusive. And if we want to teach young people about history, it's a great way to get them involved.
So I have a question,
yes, sir,
a follow-up to Commissioner Newman's comments. We have to reject those proposals that was given us on the art if we choose to put that somewhere else based on the motion?
I think if we're going to delay a decision for any length of time, they could expect it and,
okay,
should expect
so
an
we're
answer.
We're basically giving them an answer, but they could also come back with that later.
They could.
With the same bid. Okay.
If we are instructed to go back out for bids, yes.
I mean, I'm seeing this as a combination of everything, you know, when we get down to the end of it, that, you know, it's not going to be one size fits all. It's going to be, you know, there could be some art somewhere in the history, and then the history wall, you know, being very inclusive and getting everybody involved. I see this changing. But I also saw some of the artists' presentations that I thought were very well done and, mm-hmm, and reasonable, too.
Okay. Any other comments?
I support the direction that this is going in, and I just want to underline, it's not just about the final product, but it's about the way we get to the final product. So, as that process goes forward, for example, this is just an example, and it's one person saying it, it's not. But if we wanted to include, you know, have a broader inclusion of, for the process, we could go to the African American Commission and say, we've got this RFP, you know, here is our approach to releasing it. Are there other arenas that we are needing to, or what, you know, so, mm-hmm, not just this, is it this or is that, or, mm-hmm, could you help us, you know, determine inclusion on a wall once we get there, but actually be part, back it up,
right,
and be part of the
That's
process
exactly
going
right.
forward. So just wanted to kind of highlight, underline, bold, exclamation point, that going forward, and add that in.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner Jones. Any other comment from the commission?
Just one more.
Mr. Frost?
I'm 100% there, and I think that we ought to get the community totally involved, the African-American community and the board, Gigi and her people. Mr. Young needs to be involved because, gentlemen, the railroad, 1886 or whenever, appreciate you bringing that. But I still like the thoughts of a rotating. That means, you know, as the children come up, they can go in and see from history. Then they can see a little more of the history. Then they can see more of the history after so many years, and then it rotates back. Because that's what history is and what he brought forward tonight with the railroad coming here and stuff is stuff that I truthfully did not know. So I think we can all work together. We do have to have the inclusion, Ms. Frost. I agree with you 100%. And it's time to put them together to figure out exactly what we do need. I see we finally got it up here.
So,
thank you.
Can I have one more comment?
Yes,
as well?
Ma'am. Yeah, absolutely.
So I think the idea of rotating down the road, we're so far down, that's down the road that's going to happen.
Right.
But I would be remiss if I didn't say out loud that process itself excludes and includes on an ongoing basis. So we just need to be really aware. Like, I can remember, you know, some of the work for the racetrack in that memorial, and there was a lot of thought about to capture all the history and the good times and how important that was to that community. And I think changing that, it might be appropriate down the line, I don't know, but people would have feelings about that. So I just I'm not saying to not do it. I'm just saying right out loud right now to examine those pros and cons. Should that be the future, that because something's got to come off, if something's going to come on, well, what's going to come off? And you just, that's just a tricky sometimes.
Yes.
So I don't want to debate you, Mike. I'm just kind of just saying that's
just
the
one
other side.
There's one difference. The county's going to be going on for hundreds of years. We'll be gone. So the history will continue. The racetrack is history. It's done.
So there's no way to bring it forward anymore.
All right, any other comments by commissioners?
But my point is the same point, that there's still the exclusion and the inclusion. You can take away the analogy to the racetrack, but it's in and out, so.
Any other comments or discussion? The only thing I'd say about it is this is what art's about. It's discussion. It's making sure everybody's part of it. And we are a diverse community. We got to include everybody. We need to include Native Americans. We need to include African Americans. We have a great resource, the African Commission, African American Commission that Ms. Mitchell is in charge of, that we created with the city to look at these and work with them. And certainly we need to do that as much as we can. I remember, it's probably been a while, probably early years, we thought about doing a Buncombe Museum where the Biltmore School was. And then Mr. Cecil took that off our hands and made office building there. Our sheriff used to be in that. So the whole idea is to talk about it. We've got some people that have come out that want to bid on this, so I certainly think we need to delay it. Councilman and Ms. Mitchell and all the other comments, good comments you made, clearly we have to include more people, and it's not going to be this board's time to do it. We've allocated some money, but I think this board is inclined to continue and maybe go back to the drawing board, but not reject outright. Well, we are rejecting outright the bids, but not the artist. The artist did good work. And when we get good guidelines, when we get a little bit more involved, the new board grabs this and gets directives to the county manager and Ms. Francis, I think we'll have a better product because we've had some good conversations. And I thank everybody for commenting. I thank everybody for being interested in this because it is the first time Buncombe County has ever put a nickel into arts other than moving the history loop energy loop that nobody wanted. And we took it, and it's a big tourist attraction now. So, you know, I think people underestimate arts, but we want to do it right. Whatever we do, we want to do it high quality. There is money available. There may be more money available when we do the right thing and hit the right points and parts. And I salute the board. I think we're making a wise decision. Nothing would make me happier than do it. But we want to have the right thing because as the old courthouse is still going after about 90 years, this courthouse, we don't know when they'll build a new courthouse, so it could be another 90 years. And we have to plan on that. So all your comments are good. And I think we have a motion by Commissioner Frost to reject. Technically, we have to reject. We're not rejecting the artists. We're rejecting what we have in front of us and the bids themselves. And we will take no action. And the new board will, after the election, after December, first Monday in December when they're sworn in, they will take this back up, hopefully, and do something that will meet our intent and the wishes of the community and the inclusion of all people in the community. So I think that's where we're at. Any other discussion? Okay, I'll call the question. The motion by Commissioner Frost, as I understand it, is to reject the bids themselves and take no action at this time. Is that correct?
Correct.
Vice Chair?
One clarification about the motion. Is it to include just the indoor or also the outdoor?
This is just the history indoor. Wall this time. Yeah. We're going to have public hearing on the other one, although it might be a little shorter based on our conversation here. Okay, any other discussion? This is on the history wall, $25,000 allocation that we have been discussing. All right, all those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion is adopted 7-0, so we will take up the history wall at a later time.
Okay. Chairman Gamp, in terms of this next item, I'll just cut to the chase. I'm going to come to the same conclusion because of the process needing to be inclusive for that one as well. It's not going to... The merits of the art itself are not going to impact me one way or the other because the process was needs to be improved and was flawed. So I'm just putting that out there now in terms of to not kind of go through the motions just for the sake of that. And I'm ready for a second motion on the outdoor one if that would be appropriate now.
Okay.
Are we doing a public hearing on that?
Yes, I think we should, since people are here, to go ahead and take some comment on that. But I will hold that motion in abeyance to similar to the one we just voted on. So if you could give us a quick rundown, then we're going to hear from the public on the outdoor, I'll call it the monument outside the courthouse. This is a $50,000 budget that was approved about a year and a half ago.
Yeah, a quick rundown.
We actually had two proposals for the kinetic sculpture project. The first proposal was from Todd Fromm. He is an Asheville resident, and he proposed a 14-foot tall sculpture of two fighting betta fish. Each fish weighs 150 pounds. This would be sited in the Courthouse Plaza. Do I have that one? Oh. There we go. He imagined that it could be sited approximately in this location. The base of the sculpture is Corten steel, which is steel that has a finish that allows it to develop a protective patina, kind of looking rustish, but not really being rust. And the fish themselves would be stainless steel. His budget proposal was $35,000, and he expects that it can be completed in 3 to 4 months. The second proposal was from David Sheldon, who is also an Asheville native and resident. His sculpture proposal is called Equitas, which means equity. And this is one of his design sketches. This is how he envisions his final sculpture to be in the plaza. This is 15 feet tall with a 10-foot base and a 5-foot top moving part. The top part is made of stainless steel. The bottom part is made of Corten steel. His budget is $35,000 also, and he expects that once he has materials in hand, his project can be completed in 4 weeks.
Now, didn't the staff want to build one too? Just kidding.
Sure.
Just kidding.
Bad joke.
Yeah. Commissioner Bell says borrow materials from the landfill. Yeah. We might recycle. It might be a fun one. Okay. Let's go ahead and have the public hearing on this. Any members of the public wish to be heard on this? This is the monument outside the courthouse. Mr. Rice?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Being around you a long time, for years, you know I'm part of history. But I'm going to tell you, these two things that we've been presented with on the screen absolutely doesn't represent Buncombe County in any shape, form, or fashion. It represents something from Star Wars to me, and it ought to be in a museum but not in the front of the courthouse. We need something that represents our community, and I think there's, like you say, need to postpone it. But I think it needs to be a lot more thought in it. We've got an old rusty sculpture outside the window. Got another down at the federal building. Where in the name of God this stuff come from, I don't know. But it ain't representative of Buncombe County or the people of Buncombe County. If you don't represent the people, it don't need to be in front of the building. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rice. Any other members of the public wish to be heard on the outside monument proposals? Seeing none, I'll declare the public hearing part of it closed. Commissioner Jones.
I would move that we reject the proposals in hand and with a very nice letter saying that thank you for your interest and all that'll make you them feel okay about it. And then reopen the process to be more inclusive of a broader representation of our community in the process.
Second.
May I ask one question? I know that we really need to expand the process a lot, but would you be open to us looking at not only the existing proposed site, but other sites, just simply because of what's buried beneath all of that plaza? There's a lot of utilities and fiber there.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That would be part. Absolutely great.
Is there any objection to that being part of your motion? Okay. So the motion would be to reject the proposals, reopen the process, including relocate other sites. Okay.
Inquiry of the chair.
Yes, sir. Commissioner Moffitt?
Since I was not here when you guys made the decisions, was there a particular reason you wanted a kinetic type piece of art, or do we want to remove that from the process and we'll consider art that is kinetic and art that's not?
I would say so.
I know we specifically talked about kinetic at the meeting, and I think that was the motion, was to do kinetic.
Yeah.
So
this board can change that.
We can.
Anyway, especially with this motion to reject what the earlier board did. As I understand it, maybe the county attorney can help me on this, the allocation's still there. There's still money. Basically, the first motion was to reject and kind of regroup and then come back to us, I believe. This mm-hmm. one is kind of the same, a little bit more direct, to reopen the process. Is that your understanding? That's what I heard.
Okay, so if we are rejecting the current, if we're rejecting what's been presented to us, and we are opening, even possibly moving it, and we want to be inclusive, then I would suggest we not be concerned about whether it's kinetic or what it is.
That's true.
Because somebody could come back and say that we need a statue. So I don't know where this will end up. So I don't think we should hang on to, if we're scrapping it, we're scrapping it. And
okay.
That would be my suggestion.
Mr. Jones, are you good with that in your motion?
I think I would like, since it was my motion, I think maybe kind of the opening up of either or, as opposed to scrapping something, but just kind of like this be where it's including beyond kinetic.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Commissioner Jones has made a motion to reject the current proposals, not the artist, the proposals before us, to reopen the process to include non-kinetic and kinetic structures in both the courthouse and other sites that might be more appropriate. That it?
Okay.
Is there a second to that?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Fryer. Is there any further discussion? Again, I just repeat, this is part of art. We want to have discussion. We want people to talk about it. We want people to learn from it, think about it, and I think in that sense we've been successful. Again, nothing would make me better than to see something now, but it's got to be the right thing, because this, again, will be here for many years after all of us are gone. So, okay. Sounds good. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Then that motion is adopted by a 7-0 vote. Thank you, Ms. Francis. Okie doke. Next up we have resolution amending resolution 13-4, setting guidelines for funding of nonprofit agencies. Rachel is here, I think, to talk about what we have now, and I think board members will talk about the changes. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
I'm pausing to see if the slides appear. Good evening. I'm Rachel Nygaard, and I'm here this evening to share information with you about the Buncombe County community funding process as an introduction to your discussion on setting guidelines for the funding of nonprofit organizations. In my capacity as a planner evaluator for Buncombe County Health and Human Services, I provide support for this process. Buncombe County Community Funding is our annual community development grant process through which the county provides investment in community outcomes in alignment with the county's strategic sustainability goals. Funded organizations work in the areas of economy, environment, and community, achieving outcomes in alignment with the goals and objectives from the county's sustainability plan. The next slide describes the funding process. The driver for the funding process is, the driver for the funding process is the priorities that are set by the Board of Commissioners. In recent years, our practice has been to use the sustainability plan, the strategic plan for the county, as that framework. Agencies apply online through a standardized process, an application similar to what other funders in Western North Carolina use. We use the same software, and we select application questions from the same menu of questions as used by other grant makers in our region. And thank you. This application, this online application process, typically happens in November or December. The next step in the process is oral presentations from the nonprofit organizations in support of their applications, and this typically takes place in spring, early spring. And throughout the county's annual budgeting process, staff provides support by reviewing applications, conducting analysis, compiling information for the board. Ultimately, funding decisions are made in conjunction with budget adoption, which occurs in June. Once the award period takes effect in July, grants are administered as performance-based contracts. Nonprofit organizations submit financial information, such as tax filings, financial statements, expense documents. They also submit regular performance reports, providing updates about the activities and their outcomes. These reports are compiled quarterly into a performance analysis review report, which is shared with the governing body. In your packets this evening, you have copies of that performance analysis report, the FY16 year-end scorecard, as well as the fiscal year 17 first quarter report. The next slide is an overview of applicable funding resolutions and a summary of the proposed changes up for discussion this evening. In 2008, the Board of Commissioners adopted a resolution setting guidelines on the funding of nonprofit agencies. That resolution established the application process and performance contracting requirement, as well as set capital funding limitations. In 2013, the Board of Commissioners amended the previous resolution, specifying a guideline for nonprofit administrative overhead and established a requirement for nonprofit financial assurances. And this evening's proposed resolution that's on the agenda would further amend the guidelines in the following ways, specifically clarifying department level contracts versus community development grants. There is more than one mechanism for nonprofit organizations to receive funding through Buncombe County, so this clarification specifies that the resolution is applicable to the community development grants process. The second change is that it creates a tiered structure for the nonprofit financial assurances. Those financial reporting requirements would be adjusted to accommodate organizations of different sizes. It also would introduce a requirement that funds serve Buncombe County residents only. It contains an open meetings and public records requirement for nonprofit governing boards. And finally, it restricts funding to startup projects with a limitation of 3 years. And I'd be happy to answer any questions about the process, not the proposed changes to the resolution, but the community development funding process, if you have any.
Just one quick clarification. So currently, as the we have the two avenues for funding from Buncombe County, but is my understanding that the rigor of analysis is equal in terms of the requirements of financial documentation, outcome measures, quarterly reports, Is that right? Or?
Sure. I can't speak for all department level contracts, but being a staff person who's embedded within the Health and Human Services Department and working with divisions, say there's a division that wants to purchase a service and go out, say, in an RFP that's not part of the community development grant process, we may select a nonprofit organization, and we still deploy the performance-based contracting structure and require financial reporting. The open books rules would still apply.
Thank you.
It's the competitive application process and other elements within this resolution that are specific to the grant process.
Thank you.
Just a comment. I think one of the challenges, though, in the measurement which you have here is that we've had some grants where the amount has been, you know, say under $5,000, and they're measured with the same. They're measured the same as $100,000, right?
Similarly, the report that you have in front of you attempts to provide a standardized scorecarding approach, and it's tricky to hit that right note and find a sort of one-size-fits-all that will accommodate. There really is a wide range of programs that are funded through this process, covering lots of different program areas. Some have clients that are individuals who are served. Some are capital in nature, economic or environmental. So this just provides a sort of summary snapshot.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Ms. Nygaard before we start a public hearing on this?
Thank you.
We'll stay in the building. We may have some more. Any members of the public wish to be heard on the proposal to look at and change the nonprofit guidelines for the guidelines for funding of nonprofit agencies? Mr. Rice? Anyone besides Mr. Rice tonight? Okay. Jerry?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I done said most of what I wanted to say about the nonprofits, but my concern is how good have you analyzed this as your staff has put it to you in terms of what you're proposing here, because this is an issue that's so politicized that it's not even funny, because it's all about politics in the past, and it's still looking like still like politics. If this is not based on outcome goals, if we look at Buncombe County right now and see the last two articles that come out and ask for citizen, and look at the poor people in this community, and then we talk about the hundreds of these nonprofits, the outcome is not achieving the goal. It never has, and I don't see what you got on this piece of paper achieving that goal. Now, you can be embarrassed, or you can be enlightened, or you can just jump on the wagon and, you know, go for the political shot next year. You know, same old thing, same old tune, over and over, don't get it. Contracts, you've been paying out money all these years on contracts anyway. Now you're trying to separate it out. When you separate it out, you're just going to put more money in the coffer. These contracts is already mixed in the money anyway. But you're going to increase it because you're going to add more nonprofits. But the outcome of these nonprofits, what is it really coming down to? Who is measuring it? Nobody gets up here and talk about the measurements of these things. They're always talking about how can we get more. It's time to analyze these things and quit throwing money at it. Just because we got a big budget, we got plenty of money rolling in, and next year we're going to have even more. We got all this tax coming in. We got even Henderson County wanting to get money now off of the sales tax. I mean, it's all about a lot of money. It's not about the people. It's time to look at the people and the benefits of the people in our community. And I don't see how you're going to let nonprofits serve people in Buncombe County and not serve the city of Asheville. I don't understand that. Or is that, am I wrong?
You're wrong.
Okay, I'm wrong.
Fun to say.
Okay. Then it still comes to the bottom line. You're not doing a good job, and you haven't been, because it don't show the outcomes of being good. Period. Prove me wrong. I'd love it.
Thank you, Mr. Rice. Is there any other members of the public that wish to be heard on the proposed amendment to the nonprofit funding? Seeing none, I'll declare the public hearing closed. Discussion and potential action on the resolution that we have in front of us.
I have a question about, one, I want to thank the staff because I think the vetting, all the work that you all do to go over these community funding grants is enormous. But I have a question about number three, and with April here, if somebody were to arrive at the Family Justice Center battered and beaten, would they have to show their ID to prove that they were Buncombe County, or would they be accepted and taken care of and treated humanely? Because according to this, they would not be served.
I can't totally speak for them, but I can say HelpMate is a nonprofit that we partially fund and we contract with, but they have other funding that they could choose to serve people from outside Buncombe County if they wanted to. So I don't think they'd get turned away, but April, I don't know what you said.
Burgess, you can come up. Why don't you come up to the microphone?
I mean, my question is a little bit rhetorical.
Rhetorical. Yeah, they're not going to get turned away.
No. Well, that is exactly what the proposal says, though.
Yeah.
Thank you for that question, Commissioner. My answer to that is pretty clear. It's a requirement of HelpMate's federal funding that we not discriminate based on where somebody comes from, where they live. And so we would be required by federal law to provide those services. And so we're grateful for the funding that Buncombe County provides to us. We put it to good use and hope to change and save lives by using that funding. And we would, if required, use another funding mechanism to make sure that we provided those services to somebody that showed up and needed our help. But I think the question is a good one, and I appreciate you asking it.
I have a question, Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir. Commissioner Muff.
This is not the sole funding that these organizations get. It's from Buncombe County. These organizations get funding from any number of sources. This is, in particular, just referring to funds that this body has appropriation power over and how that money is to be used when we authorize its authorize the funding. So to the point that Commissioner Frost made, I don't see that particular section 3 as a tool to turn people away from receiving services, but it is something that we need to consider as a body in regards to we only govern over Buncombe County tax dollars and how those are used. Other county commissioners have the same challenge in front of them. So from a clarification standpoint, those dollars should be going to serve our residents. But clearly in these emergency situations, there are plenty of funds that these organizations have to where that would not be a disqualifying statement if it was part of our resolution.
Any other comments? All right. Well, as I understand our current law, and Rachel, maybe if you can respond, we do require open books when we ask for them. Is that correct?
That's correct.
We do require annual financial statements.
Correct.
We do require audited financial statements.
Correct.
Right now, under our current law, right?
Current resolution requires.
We require IRS 990s.
Correct.
Would you tell the public what that is exactly and what information that has?
The 990 is the IRS Form 990, which is the tax filing form for nonprofit organizations. So it includes much of the same information that a financial statement, an audited financial statement, would include with revenue and expenses and financial position.
Okay, we do require performance contracts that we get quarterly reports on.
Correct.
So if someone's not performing in the second quarter, we're going to know about it the second quarter. We're not going to find out the day before we have to review the contract for the following year. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Capital funding has to require some type of match from a foundation or gift. We don't give unless someone else is giving.
I believe that's accurate. You have the resolution in front of you.
Okay. And then there are limits on how much capital funding can't be 10%. It's the lesser of 10% or 500,000.
That sounds accurate.
And it's paid over 5 years, right now under our current policy.
Correct.
Okay. I like the conversation. This is about the fourth conversation I've been involved in 20 years, and I think it's always useful to get to ask, are we doing the taxpayers right? Are we good stewards of the money? So I salute the I like the flexibility that we have and the accountability. I think there's a balance here. Buncombe County is known throughout the state and really throughout the country for partnering with people. There are two models you have here. You can do we're going to do it ourselves, government can do it better than anybody, or you can partner with Helpmate, Eblen, different charities and foundations that are on the front lines doing it every day. We choose the latter. We're going to work with people, and in my experience, it makes the money go further. There's not a single one of these contracts or grants that doesn't go toward either a core service or some service that we want to provide, and the board has consciously made a decision, this is something we want to do. So anybody that gets up here and suggests that we like them, they're going to vote for us, so we're going to throw them some money, is mistaken. And that's never been the case. So I feel we've got the right balance. I like the discussion. I don't think I can support it because I think that as we evolve, as we change, our community changes, our goals change, I like the board to have the flexibility to not be tied quite as tight as they would be under the proposed changes. So that's my view. Other commissioners?
Well, I think that the proposal does help us in trying to define between contracts and grants. We do struggle every year with that process. There are some smaller amounts that, you know, I believe, you know, should be treated just simply as grants. But there are some of the things that we're looking at the same time should be contract based, and I see this allowing us to have more of that, particularly with Health and Human Services. And the point has been made, you know, are we getting the results? And that's the only reason you measure. Measuring is never negative. Measuring is always about trying to get more return, more help out there. And that's why we look at it and we measure and we coach through the relationships with Health and Human Services. And particularly in that department is where a lot of these contracts, I believe, would fall and be able to deliver better services, because some nonprofits can deliver better services than we can do internally, and that's why we want those contracts. I don't think any of those folks are against having more dialogue, discussion, more review, and trying to improve that process and deliver more services to the ground. And I do see that some of this would actually help that. And I like that. In 2013, you know, I think I was involved in the discussion, I think maybe Ms. Frost too, about helping come up with a number that was recommended for administrative costs. That was not a negative. That was an opportunity for us to look at some of the very well-run nonprofits to deliver more services to the ground. And that's what we want. more services delivered. But there is some conflict between the contracts and grants, and I see that this could help with some of that.
Other discussion or comments? Is there a motion?
Mr. Chair.
Commissioner.
In light of some new information provided this evening, I would move that we remove the resolution from the agenda for further consideration down the road.
Second.
Okay, there's been a motion by Commissioner Moffitt, second by Commissioner Vice Chair Newman. Is there any further discussion? It's an ongoing discussion, and it's a good one to have. And I think it is something. I think you're going to have a new board after the election and swearing in December, and it's certainly one that would continue. Any other comments? All those in favor of Commissioner Moffitt's motion, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Then that is approved by 7-0 vote. Next, we have a matter carried over from the consent agenda, the resolution of intent to solicit bids for the sale of Buncombe County property. Dr. Green?
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, we own a piece of property at 125 South Lexington Avenue. It's Unit A101 in the Lexington Station condominium complex. We acquired this property in the 2006-2007 time frame. It was built in 2007, really. And Handmade occupied this space for a long time under a lease with option to acquire the property. When they closed, we inherited the property back, and we were able to move air quality into that area to give us some ability to move some other people around. It's a 4,400 square foot facility, has a 400 square foot deck on it and 5 secure parking places, but it's really not very accessible to the public. So when we look at that and we look at some space we have on this floor, I am going to move air quality in to this floor, and it vacates the building, so we'd like to put it up for upset bid. The appraised price on it is $615,000, and we're asking you tonight to declare it surplus and then to declare your intent to accept offers beginning at $615,000 and start the upset bid process. We are working pretty hard based on some instructions we have from y'all a number of months ago to try to really use the property we have and move on and sell the property that's not useful to us.
Are any questions for Dr. Green? All right, we have a proposal in front of us. Is there a motion to adopt the resolution to solicit bids for the upset?
I adopt.
Commissioner Fryer, motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Commissioner Frost. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. 7-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Next, any commissioner have any comments?
Chairman Gant, I would love to have some comments about, I've been following the our community's response to early voting, and I just wanted to take a couple of minutes to really commend our Board of Elections, our bipartisan Board of Elections, and our excellent Director of Election Services, Trina Parker. It's just been excellent how things have gone so far. And when I'm 99.9% sure that Buncombe County, when early voting started, had the most number of early voting sites in any county across North Carolina, more than Wake, more than Mecklenburg. And consequently, our citizens got excellent service, and their time was really appreciated. And I think, I don't know about y'all, but I've gotten fantastic feedback about how easy it is to vote. And sometimes there's a wait, but that's appropriate too. And consequently, because of this great leadership, to date, 80,000 Buncombe County citizens have voted, which converts into about a 41% voter turnout to date. And incidentally, that is with the support of not only an excellent staff,
but about 273 volunteers from, you know, from both parties that are facilitating a smooth process and a fair process and a transparent process. When we ramp up for actual election day, it's going to be about 543 volunteers. So I just think that's outstanding, and I think we're on track to break the records for 2012. I know so many counties across the state have been experiencing obstacles to voting, and I'm just wanting to celebrate the good work of our Board of Elections and that leadership with Chairman Watson and Ms. Smith and Mr. Keller and of course Trina, who is just always brilliant. And so we've got a lot to celebrate here, and I just appreciated the time to make note of that.
Thank you, Commissioner Jones. Any other comments? Yes. Commissioner Frost?
I know you still have one more meeting, but I also know how much the art projects meant to you and all the other wonderful things, which I don't want to get all, but the art project is not going to go for naught, and whether you're here or not, you will be driving that project.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm sure the board will make good decisions. Any other comments?
Yeah, I'm going to be chairman of the art committee.
is that a motion?
A new role.
It's not on the agenda.
Not properly
before the board. Thank you for the kind words. Any other comments? Okay, we do not have a closed session. I'll do the announcements, and then we'll take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
November 8 is Election Day. November 11, the county offices will be closed for Veterans Day. November 15, we'll have new commissioner orientation on the first floor conference room at 200 College Street in downtown Asheville at 8 a.m. November 15, we will also have a regular meeting of this board beginning at 4:30 at 200 College Street, room 326, and we will be closed for Thanksgiving, November 24 and 25. Any other matters come before the board? If not, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Mr. Belcher, second?
Second.
Mr. Jones, all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned 7-0. Thank you.